Okay.
Maybe the nice weather is tempting people to stay home. I hope not. I only heard from Greg tonight that he wasn't going to be here, so I'm just going to assume that folks are going to wander in. So thanks, everyone, for being here and for being on time. Here comes Maddie, and here comes Michael. Good. So not that homelessness and crimes and drugs aren't fun to talk about, but I, for one, am looking forward to changing the pace a little bit of our meetings and turning tonight to arts, culture, and recreation, just a little bit of a lightening of the mood, like the sky is lighter outside, so I'm ready to have a lighter mood, and I'm guessing that most of you all might be as well. So we do arts, culture, and recreation tonight, and then we will look at parks and environmental stewardship at the next meeting on April 10th. So doing some really fun stuff here, and I'm looking forward to it. We have a couple of presenters tonight to give us some ideas, and then we're breaking up into small groups as we've done before, and you'll all brainstorm, and then we'll get some draft recommendations down on paper and take it from there. And then we want to talk about any additional revisions to the housing recommendations. You got my email earlier this week that had a second draft of those. Thanks to everyone for your edits. So we'll look at those one more time. And then I had talked to you on the agenda and in my emails about a discussion we need to have tonight about the two topics of education and transportation, because we've done some thinking about that. They're both scheduled for one meeting, and we've done some thinking about whether or not maybe you will have done your education recommendations already, and that's why you got, as a part of your packets tonight, the draft education recommendations that you've developed together, and then thinking about transportation in a different way than big roads and corridors, but really focusing on the things that you have said were priorities to you earlier: pedestrian safety, bicycle, transit cross town, that kind of thing, and just really focusing there on transportation rather than on the more traditional what's the next highway and what's going to happen that we might want to enter into. So just some things to think about. We'll do that for the very last minute, or the last several minutes on our agenda tonight, and then talk about the working draft going forward, and we'll take it from there. So thanks, everyone, for being here. Looks like we got a good crowd. We have a couple of presenters tonight. Carol Thomas, who's the Cultural Arts Director. You guys can come on up. And for the City of Everett, and Lori Cummings, who is the Parks and Recreation Director. And we're just going to turn it over to them. It'll be a 15 to 20 minute presentation as usual. And then we'll ask for very quick, just clarifying questions, and then get into your groups as quickly as we can. Because when you break into groups, you can go back and get a cookie on your way back to your group. Bob has changed his tune. He's starting to bring cookies to the meetings.
Thank you, Bob.
It's kind of a, it's,
beat me up enough, I can take a
hit. It's kind of a major breakthrough here. So, you know, we're halfway through. We're starting to at least get our cookies. It's pretty good. All right. So I'll let you guys.
And I'm assuming this mic is on?
Yeah. And you can take it out of there if you want to wander a little bit. Perfect. Whatever you feel most comfortable with.
Wonderful. I'm Lori Cummings. I'm the director for the Parks and Community Services Department for the City of Everett. Thank you all for being here. It's nice to see a lot of new faces and a few of those that I've worked with before. I'm here tonight to just give you a very brief overview of the recreation component of our Parks and Community Services Department. I thought that it would make sense to give you a quick overview of really the guide that we use in our Parks and Community Services Department. We just finished our Parks, Recreation, and Open Space Plan update. This is all available online, but I do have a notebook if anyone's interested. We finished that last spring of 2016. Then this really is the guide that we use in terms of both the park side of the department and the community services and recreation side. It's meant to be broad and comprehensive in nature, and to just provide us a framework for what we do on both the parks and the recreation side. What's important to know is that part of this effort, updating this plan every 6 years, is a very active community engagement process. And so as early as last spring, we finished 19 neighborhood meetings, had over 200 participants, and received over 3,000 comments via surveys from our community about what they'd like to see in parks and recreation, and our plan reflects their feedback and their priorities. So I'll just give you a couple of the highlights on the recreation side, and then whether I probably will be back here on the 10th of April as well to talk about parks. But on the recreation side, we heard our community talk about the value that they have for the Forest Park Swim Center and how important that is for them. Our outdoor programs, our health and fitness programs. We have a lot of programs for adults in those areas. And on the youth side of things, our animal farm, our Jetty Island days, and our day camps were really important. The camp that we have for special needs, Camp Patterson, I'll give you a little more information on in a minute or two, but those were things that were important, and we heard a lot about those during our outreach, during our PROS plan community engagement process. We use what are called the three pillars from the National Recreation and Park Association as our guides in terms of how we operate both on the parks and the recreation side. And so the three pillars are health and wellness, social equity, and conservation. So I'm going to touch just for a couple of minutes on the health and wellness and the social equity components. We'll talk about conservation under the auspices of parks at your April 10th meeting. In terms of health and wellness, we divide our recreation division into five core program areas: aquatics, athletics, outdoor, enrichment, and I'm missing the fifth one. The ex-park director, I'll remember it. When I go through here, I'll remember it. On the way here, I was stumped. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about each one. For under the umbrella of aquatics, as you know, we have the Forest Park Swim Center. We have about 15 to 20,000 individuals using just our general public swim. We have about 68 lessons that we provide and water fitness classes, of which it's about 2,500 kids that participate in our swim program throughout the year. In terms of enrichment, we have a preschool that we operate. It's a recreational preschool. It's not an educational preschool, but it's been in, I believe we're about in our 33rd year for the preschool that we offer. Our day camps are very popular. We offer day camps for kids for science, our Jetty Nature Camp. We have an adventure camp for kids that want to do more outdoor type programs. And then Camp Patterson, which I referenced earlier, is in its 52nd year, I believe. It's a special needs camp that we hold at Silver Lake, and it's really one of the only in the area. We serve about 300 kids in that summer special needs camp. It's an integrated camp, and so we do see not only special needs, but normal average need kids as well in that camp. And we offer a day camp called Code 10, which is free and targets low-income children. We have one site in the North Everett area and one site in the South Everett area. And so it's a place for the kids to be able to go. We target schools that have the free and reduced lunch program and high percentage of the kids that are part of the free and reduced lunch program so that they're not only able to have a place to go during the day, but also there's a meal certainly provided at those schools. In terms of enrichment, our outdoor for one of our core program areas, we have about 700 participants in outdoor programs. A lot of adults take part in the hikes, the snowshoe trips, the walking program as well, and they're an avid and loyal group to us. Each of those participants attends about four of those outdoor programs annually, so they're very loyal, and it's a very important core program area that we have. We have several fitness and health programs, some nutritional programs for both youth and adults, and what I would call the stereotypical fitness classes, aerobic classes, dance classes, and such as well. Under the umbrella of athletics, we offer facilities that we provide fields. We have about 4,000 different rentals of our fields. That's about 8,000 hours worth of field use for organizations and teams that participate in soccer and baseball and Little League. A lot of those athletic fields we offer as part of a partnership, so you'll see nonprofit organizations actually offer those programs, and our role is to help facilitate fields for them to be able to utilize. So partnerships are really important to us. The Little League, lacrosse organization, Puget Sound Adult Basketball, the Snohomish County Adult Soccer Association, as well as the North County Youth Soccer Association, are strong users of our facilities and partners with us. We couldn't offer all those programs without the nonprofit agencies. And we have a strong and very valuable school district interlocal that's part of what we do. So if the school district is an excellent partner with us, where we share facilities with them and they share facilities with us. I also want to add that under the umbrella of recreation, we offer facilities such as our animal farm that I mentioned earlier, where we saw about 34,000 visitors this past summer. It's a 9-week program. The Jetty Island Days program you may be aware of, where we transport youth and adults by ferry boat from the 10th Street boat launch over to Jetty Island. It is a free program. We encourage donations with that program, and we saw just under 37,000 participate in that 9-week program as well. We also offer facility rentals under the umbrella of recreation, so our hall facilities and our picnic shelters. Picnic shelters are in high demand and were something the community told us they're very interested in when it comes to use of, or when it came to our PROS plan survey work. And then I would be remiss if I didn't mention our senior center. The Parks and Community Services Department began overseeing the senior center about a year and 3-4 months ago. And that facility, if you're not familiar with it, is for seniors 50 and older. It's a vibrant and active facility. They not only offer active classes in fitness, and some trips as well, but the passive type activities for seniors who aren't able to be as active, such as they have knitting clubs and bingo, kind of the stereotypical, what I would say, opportunities, as well as those that are more active. We have a very active 50-plus table tennis program at the senior center. In addition to the recreation components at the senior center, there's a really strong health component as well. We have nurses part-time at the senior center. We have a social worker that we contract with through Senior Services of Snohomish County. And we also provide meals 5 days a week at lunch for the seniors. So those are important activities. So I think that's my 7.5 minutes. So Carol's going to speak to you about cultural arts. Oh. I guess I missed a few slides here. I'm sorry. Let's see what I missed. I'm sorry. I got so excited talking about what I'm going to do. Oh, let me talk about social equity for just a moment. Social equity really, really kind of spans the spectrum of equity. And in this case, we talk about some gender equity, some geographic equity, and ethnicity. Also, socioeconomic equity is important to us as well. So as we're developing recreation programs, we again look at this pillar that is part of the National Recreation and Parks Association in terms of social equity. Probably the best example of the socioeconomic equity is our scholarship program. We have a robust scholarship program. We offer 70% scholarships and don't turn individuals away if they can't afford the other 30%. But we have some criteria that ensures that those in the low-income bracket are able to participate in our recreation programs by this scholarship program. That's in partnership with the Community Foundation of Snohomish County, so always good partners for us. Okay, that now ends my presentation.
Okay. Hi. I'm Carol Thomas, Cultural Arts Manager with the City of Everett. And let's take a look there. So I was referring back to the vision plan that was created by a group similar to this in 2003. That was 14 years ago. And at that time, there were very specific requests for growth in the cultural arts. And so to lay the framework and kind of put us in perspective, in 2003, when this committee got together, the arts establishments that we had in downtown Everett were two. We had the Historic Everett Theater, which is on Colby Avenue, and we had the Everett Performing Arts Center. And since that time, the request of the Vision Committee was to establish an arts district in downtown where a variety of activities create synergy and redevelopment, including housing, stores, restaurants, theaters, libraries, museums, and galleries. And in 2003, so since the time of the Vision Committee, the Everett Event Center and Arena has been built. Oops, that was a little fast. The Imagine Children's Museum got a beautiful new location. They had been in an old building that the city leased to them in the old Combeck building, but a beautiful, beautiful location downtown. That was 2004. In 2005, the City of Everett acquired property adjacent to the Everett Performing Arts Center, including an existing bank building, which is the old Key Bank building, and it's a beautiful representation of 1960s World Fair architecture. And in 2010, the city began work on a brand new plaza, the Wetmore Theater Plaza, and started building out the old Key Bank building, one, preserving a really special piece of architecture in downtown Everett, but also building a youth education center, which is now called the Cope Gillette Theater. In 2011, okay, that's another picture of the Wetmore Theater Plaza. In 2011, work began on the Shack Art Center and Art Space. It was on land that the city deeded over for the building of this place. It was the old Hoyt Avenue garage, and turned that into 40 artist spaces, live-in art lofts, and also the Shack Art Center, gallery, hot shop, and a place that's vibrant and full of classes. We'll go right to the sculpture. In 2012, the city designated Hoyt Avenue as their arts district for festivals and events. And since the year 2003, the city has installed about 37 sculptures downtown and 10 sculptures at the Evergreen Arboretum. So there's one thing about building the infrastructure of a cultural arts district, and there's another thing about energizing it. So another thing that this group asked for in 2003 was to provide a superior cultural environment where cultural arts thrive. And the Village Theater at Everett has the largest number of season subscribers in the Northwest, with the single exception of the Fifth Avenue Theater. Last year there were 55,000 theater goers. The Imagine Children's Theater has 230,000 visitors annually. The Shack Art Center, last year there were more than 39,000 visitors to the Shack from 45 states and from 26 different countries. The Cope Gillette Theater, the Little Black Box Theater for youth education, has 1,500 students annually and is looking for more space to expand. Xfinity Arena and the Hanson Conference Center have about 400 visitors annually. 400. So, 400,000, what did I say, 400? It's been a long day. 400,000. So what I would say is not only have we built the infrastructure, and I don't mean like the city, but in partnership with all these wonderful organizations, but the spaces have been activated. Another thing that was requested by the Vision Group 13 years ago was that there be living wage jobs in the cultural arts. The Shack Art Center has got 4 FTE employees plus numerous part-time employees. They have 99 artists teaching classes, 728 artists represented in the galleries and exhibits. The Imagine Children's Museum has 37 staff, 12 educators, 4 arts educators. Funko, which is our new retail gallery downtown on Wetmore Avenue, which is opening in late summer, they're estimated to have over 150 employees, and many of those will be artists and graphic designers, great paying jobs. Village Theater each year contracts with about 400 different artists to put on their productions. Now, they're not full-time here in Everett, but it's impressive. And Kids Stage Youth Program has 9 full-time staff. So the jobs are coming in. Another thing that this committee asked for 14 years ago was cultural activities that are accessible to every citizen regardless of age, income, or ability. And I passed out an example of some of the things the City of Everett does each year. This was from 2016, but it gives you an idea of the events that the city produces that are free, open to the public, always family-friendly, wheelchair accessible. And a lot of them are based in downtown, but some of our very best events that we do are out at Silver Lake. We do our Cinema Under the Stars on Friday nights out there. We get probably 500 to 800 people out there, depending on weather and the movie. And our children's series, which is now in year, I think, 29, and that's also out at Silver Lake on Thursday mornings. Very popular events. So the last thing the committee asked for all those years ago was a good place to live, work, and create. And I would have to say that there is such an influx of young, artistic, creative, wow, energetic young people in the city. I'm very impressed with them. And Sketchy Everett or Kristen Boswell with Everett Makers. So I do feel like we're creating, that Everett is creating a vibrant place to live. So that's kind of the report card.
We have about 5 minutes for some quick questions for our two presenters. Anybody got a question?
Yeah,
Maddie.
Can both of you talk a little bit about the funding and, you know, do your programs break even with what you bring in versus, you know, can you just address that a little?
Can we go first?
Yes.
So the programs vary in terms of funding. We are a general fund department. We have a cost-benefit policy that we established in 2007, and that provides us a framework, and it was adopted by council, for how we price our programs. And so our mission is to make sure we're providing affordable recreational opportunities, but they range in terms of how we determine price based on the more individual benefit versus a community benefit. So an example of a community benefit would be a special event where we don't charge an entrance fee to a special event. It's free and open to the public. Our playgrounds, of course, those kinds of things. An example of a highly individualized program might be a trip, a hike that an adult takes outside of the city, and the benefit to them as an individual is really high. And so we range our recovery rate on our programs based on a spectrum between the individual, highly individual, and the community benefit.
For cultural arts, all of the events we do are free, open to the public, and they're paid for with our City of Everett budget. Areas where we have to fundraise to make ends meet are certainly the fireworks show each year. So we write grants, and we get sponsorships for that.
And your music, right?
We do get sponsorships for music at the marina, but frankly, that's within the budget, and it's not such a big hurdle to overcome as raising funds for the fireworks.
Okay. Sharita.
I am curious on, I know that a group that I'm associated with is working on a cultural arts installation piece. And I'm curious on if there are opportunities for different neighborhoods and areas and districts to create opportunities to put in art installations. And I know that we've got a designated area downtown, but I'm wondering if neighborhoods and other shopping areas would be able to have opportunity to create art, and even mini pocket parks in their districts or in their areas.
I think that's a great idea. I will tell you, in the downtown plaza, there were community workshop days where people built mosaics to place inside the wall. One of the things that I think is most compelling is interactive arts, like our Street Tunes programs, Pianos on the Street, or our Word on the Street, where people are typing away stories, et cetera, like that. So I think that that would be wonderful. Now, how we do it, well, we'd have to sit down and work out a plan, but...
Are the pianos and the typewriters, are those put throughout the city, or are they mostly concentrated in the downtown core?
They're mostly concentrated in the downtown core. What we need to make it work is we need to have a business that's open 7 days a week who's willing to go out and cover it up if it starts to rain, that kind of a thing. So we usually put them by retails, restaurants, etc., who will take care of them.
And sorry, one more follow-up question. So is that something that would be available to do in other neighborhoods around the city as opposed to just to the downtown area, or is that something that's just specific to the core, the downtown?
It has been specific to downtown. It could work in many other places in the city, so long as we can find the people who will go out and, you know, slip a bag over them when it starts to sprinkle.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Chris.
Thank you for the report card on both. Obviously, what we're focused on is the next 20 years. Could you talk a little bit about what policies and actions you have in process now and where you see things going over the next 20 years before we get into small groups and talk about the same thing?
Where I see things going over the next 20 years?
That's right.
I think that as people move into downtown Everett, which they are doing, and businesses like Funko come in with so many artistic employees, that private businesses and galleries and so on will really create a very vibrant downtown.
Well, that's for the city, but for cultural arts, what are other policies or actions that you see playing out or plans that are already in place that you could talk a little bit about to let us know where you're headed at this point?
We're really just headed in creating a vibrant downtown. I don't have a policy plan for the next 20 years.
As in terms of recreation, we use the Parks and Recreation Open Space Plan, the six-year comprehensive plan, as a tool. It is fairly broad, and what I see over the next 20 years is the community interested in more social gatherings, special events, the fitness-oriented, the walking, the being outdoors more is what the trends seem. There seems to be some trends in that direction for us as well.
Thank you.
Maddie?
I don't know if this falls under parks, but Lori, can you talk a little bit about the fact that we have two golf courses, and what I heard at a couple meetings ago is that most cities our size have one golf course, and I don't know if that falls under the parks conversation or if that, to me, that's more recreation, but can you just address that a little, and is there any thoughts about that? And
so just as late as March 1st, I presented to City Council our intent to launch a golf analysis, and which will be extensive and may take up to a year to complete. And some of the questions that you just asked will be part of that analysis. So it would be premature for me to speculate where I think we'll go, but we'll be looking at the market. We will be looking at other cities of our size and what they offer in terms of golf opportunities. Our golf courses are in what's called an enterprise fund, and so the expectation is that they are financially sustainable on their own. The general fund does not support the golf fund at this point, and so the task in front of us is to determine how we can continue to be financially sustainable with golf. And so the options are completely open. We're saying everything is on the table in terms of what considerations we might make, but we have a lot of research to do.
Lori, I wonder if you could add, because it's come up in this committee before, if, for example, in several years the Walter Hall Golf Course was no longer used for golf, what can that property be used for? Are there limitations?
There are. The, most of that property is in perpetuity, needs to be for outdoor recreation, and that's based on funding received from the state. And so as we continue to look at options, that will be something that we need to consider, is it needs to be dedicated to outdoor recreation. Now, that there has there isn't an opportunity to mitigate that through a conversion process, but that's challenging and expensive to do, and so it's not impossible, but certainly you basically have to find a similar amount of property in a similar area that could provide similar outdoor recreation experiences. We went through that a couple of years ago on a different site, so it is a it's a challenging process, but not impossible.
So really quickly, just because I want to make sure you get in with plenty of time in your groups, and Lori and Carol will stay for to answer questions as they're roaming around. But Ben,
mine is quick. Is it parks or the cultural portion of the city that funds the Nubian Jam or allows the Nubian Jam or the Black Heritage Committee to use Forest Park every year?
That is parks, and it's done through a special use permit process where someone from that organization submits a permit, we review it, and then we do provide some staff support on site the day of the event.
It's a lot of staff support. It is. It's great.
Yeah,
I've been a part of the committee.
Yeah,
for several
it's
years.
A very popular event and an important event.
Okay, great. We have very good attendance tonight, so I don't think we have to do any manipulating in the groups. If your name has an asterisk behind it, that means you're the person welding the pin or pins. Greg is not here, so Linda. Linda just left the room. I'm wondering if Linda can take over and scribe for group three. And it looks like Carissa isn't here either. So Maddie, would you take over for your group four? Okay, have fun. Easels are spread out around the room.
First thing for the what we think the city is doing well. Overall, we think enough is being done. If you look at it holistically, events specifically, we like to the wide range of events that the city encourages and the wide range of programs, especially those for the low income, etc. Additional actions we recommend, ensuring relevance, so to every demographic of citizens, I think is what I should have wrote there. So an example of this would be the greater variety of multicultural events. So perhaps one culture is represented by a multicultural event and another one's not, something along those lines. And then wider incorporation of areas outside downtown, so expanding, whether it be expanding that district or expanding efforts to areas outside downtown. Another additional action that we recommend is just, as always, shooting for increased awareness. So this, we broke down, I think, which I really like, broke it down locally and then also as if Everett was a destination place. So our citizens need to know about what we do, but also people outside of Everett need to know so they come have some fun. And I think a product of this increased awareness that we also would recommend shooting for is that the culture, arts, and outdoor recreation become part of Everett's new image. And then also give some specific example here of the increased awareness is new mediums for outreach. You're going to ask me what that means, and I don't know. What ideas do we have for the 20-year aspirational goal? Just to kind of repeat this, the cultural arts and outdoor recreation, culture, arts, and outdoor recreation become parts of Everett's image. Also, 20 years from now, we'd love to see physical art outside of the downtown area, so in corridors and in each individual neighborhood, perhaps. And then also, one thing that we talked about at a pretty good length was this this idea that we use new development to kind of incite or create or force through new cultural and arts and recreation activities. So to step back and look at that a bit more broadly, the term we the term we looked at was, you know, looking at new development holistically. How can this increased economic activity yield more XYZ? For number four, what ideas and specific recommendations do we have? Kind of tying into this, looking at development holistically and economics as it ties into culture, arts, and recreation, leveraging area stakeholders. So we talked about the Downtown Everett Association, the business improvement area, and we're curious if they contribute to the arts that exist in Downtown Everett. So in practice, that's just including businesses and also including community in the selection of art or you know, where it goes, et cetera. And then also a specific recommendation we had was investing in blighted areas, so using the culture, the arts, and the recreation as a means to recover or promote areas that aren't doing so well. And then finally, kind of looking at civic engagement as a tool to drive participation and attendance. And I think participation is a key word there, kind of points to the goal of having citizens involved in the process of creating these things and being invested at that level. So what questions do you have for me?
So Sharita asked a question about this earlier, and I just wondered if it was sort of the general sense of your group that right now too much of the art life and the cultural engagement life is concentrated in downtown?
I wouldn't say too much, because it's a good thing that it exists, yeah. But it should be perhaps more equitable, might be the word, but exist in greater concentration outside of Downtown Everett.
And then we've talked about, you know, a larger marketing program for the city overall. So are you saying these events should be part of the marketing, or they should be marketed, or it's just?
Well, I think both things individually point towards or relate to a goal of changing Everett's image, obviously. So
okay.
I think both of these individually are means for doing that, but also, you know, of course, you want to market your events well, and your right. events should display your marketing. I think everybody agrees.
But it's back to that larger goal that we've had about kind of working
every
hard
meeting.
To change
yeah.
that, yeah, every change the image of Everett, exactly.
Yeah.
So, okay, great, very Thanks. Good, very good.
Who's going next?
Hey, Michael, yeah. could I just interject one
Please.
Thing
yes.
here? Michael did a great job presenting our very diverse views there, but what we talked about, that holistic piece, what we meant was, in many instances, have a cultural or recreational anchor drive the development in a certain area. So, and the development would be holistic in the sense that you might have housing and restaurants and recreation and culture and, you know, all the kind of mixed-use stuff all in one venue. Certainly many large eastern cities have done that to revitalize certain areas, whether it's Baltimore, D.C., Norfolk. They've all taken that kind of a combined mixed-use approach, usually anchoring around some recreational cultural center, whether it's a ballpark or a museum or whatever, and then done everything else around it. All of a sudden you've got a promenade, and then you've got new restaurants, and then you've got new hotels and new condos, and, you know, pretty soon what had been a blighted area is now a revitalized, dynamic part of the city that attracts tourists, attracts dollars, you know, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah. Great. Okay. Good. Christopher.
I apologize in advance for my handwriting. It will get worse as we go along here. I'm not joking. So for what the city's doing well, we all pretty much agree that citywide, for both recreation and for arts, there are pretty good partnerships going on, some really solid collaboration. And we included education in schools with both areas. It seems like the city is really focused on getting the kids involved, which is a vital piece. And there is some diversity here. There is some economic impact here. But leading to piece number two, We need to do twice as much as what's going on now, because there is still a lot of room and opportunity in Everett. So some of the things we had talked about were connecting the city, and not just in a sense of, you know, we're all one community. We're talking literally, physically, you know, we don't want to have all the art here. We want to spread it out, have, you know, little areas of art and recreation reflected. So you can go to downtown for a lot of stuff, but, you know, downtown gets full. Downtown may be, you know, out of reach for the moment. So we also talked about communication. I noticed today there was a very little banner on a street post somewhere, and it was something about some of the arts and things going on in downtown, but it was an accidental glimpse. You know, if Everett's going to be whatever it's going to be, people need to know, including the citizens inside of Everett. So the city getting that out there is going to be just as effective as saying, hey, we have this new exhibit, you know, make sure you come. But if we know that, that's great. If other people don't know it, it's not as effective. Plan B events. So I've been to the Newbies Jam, I think, 2 or 3 years in a row now, and it's usually kind of rainy, unfortunately, or the parking's terrible. So something as a backup, if it rains and not that many people can come, do we have a rain date set? Do we have, you know, more parking available? Just, you know, we want people to be able to come to the events if for some reason they can't. Something else for them, you know, because it's hard to rearrange your whole schedule for something that's only on one day, and it may rain out. A city guide, I personally would really like this for myself, but just in general, there's a lot in Everett right now, and we're all hoping to see so much more in Everett. But again, if people can't find it, it doesn't do us much good. I've seen things for restaurants, but it's just one little flyer and talks about the restaurants right here in downtown. It's kind of ineffective if it's such a reduced format there. More kid-friendly events and coordinations with the schools, you know, just, they're already doing a lot in the schools, but getting them outside of the schools and getting them attached to the greater city. Accessibility, kind of touched on this a little bit. And you know, if you go to the Nubian Jam, for example, if parking's full, again, not accessible. If somebody has to park at the bottom of that hill and they're, you know, they have a difficult time walking up the hill. And then we're talking about, you know, Chris had mentioned having things that are more portable, and like, we don't have to have everything over here at Forest Park. It can go to different areas of the city. Maybe, you know, throughout the few years, we'll have events that go to a different spot throughout the city. And Brenda mentioned, you know, in the winter, why not have events that are indoors and winter-friendly type events? So realistically, if people know about events, if we have enough, you know, can they get to them? And is it an all-year thing, or is it just, well, Everett's got a lot going on in the summer, but that's it? So we'd like to see more accessibility overall. And then this was a great point I thought Chris brought up. Deliberate engagement. So Funco's coming here. You know, are they going to be invested in Everett? Or is it a spot for them? Are people going to be invested in Funco? It's a big company, but do people know enough about it? So it's this two-way deliberate engagement. We also discussed Brenda's baby here, the skyline art, skyline recognition. Yeah. Chris pointed out, you know, the arts and culture and recreation are great, but they have other elements to them. They do help fight poverty. They are a catalyst for a livable city that has economic growth. And some of this art can be made by and targeted to specific areas. You know, we have a skate park here, but there's no art there. So if people are going to come there, lots of young artists and things of that nature. All right. So for number three, kind of our ideas here are our relevance, you know, ever being a destination city, which I know Michael's group talked about, and the connection to the citizens. So is the art and the culture and recreation here, is it meaningful to us? Do we have a buy-in with it? Or is it just art for art's sake? The actual aesthetic components, Brenda's idea was historic buildings have kind of their own art scheme maybe, or they have more historic friendly art, whereas some of the newer properties, it can have brighter colors or murals or whatever it is, so that people can easily identify, oh, this is a house from, you know, the early 1900s or whatever. And again, something Michael's group had touched on, but the relationship with all this to the internal citizens and the external citizens. So again, getting people to come to Everett, but the people in Everett, how do they connect with their city's arts and recreations? And something that Kika was really big on was getting schools involved, so the participation and the voice reflecting from the children and the families. If Everett's doing a lot in the schools, bringing that out to Everett on a larger scale, and city-sponsored school exhibits and engagement. So what is the city doing to really foster this in the youth and the families? And our three big things were kind of a step in the other direction, leveraging the assets that we already have. We have an arena here. You know, we have the Shack Art Center, which draws a great number of people. We have a lot of great things. Are we doing enough with these? You know, do we need to add a whole bunch of new stuff, or can we add a few really solid things but make a lot of what we have? Connecting the city, and again, this is a physical connection. So if I'm running down a trail, is there art on the trail? If I'm taking a drive, is there art there? You know, I live in the South End, is there art there, or do I have to go to, you know, do I feel excluded? And then the communication and visibility component. People need to see it, but we also need to get the word out. It's not enough just to have a great art center downtown if nobody knows about it, if it's not accessible, if it's confusing.
So that's it. Very good. So when you, back to your number two, when you said we need to be doing twice as much, mm-hmm. So does your group, were you thinking we need twice as many staff to do that, or how? How do you get to twice as much? Is that more money for the arts, or
I believe, and the group is welcome to chime in. Some of this was simply redoubling our efforts, you know, making sure, because if we rely on a small number of people to do this, it's going to take a long time. It's going to go directions that we don't want.
I think one of the things we were talking about is just including the community in creating the art, include the businesses in creating the art, and just having our existing great staff and programs that we already have maybe manage that. But I think we can leverage the budget.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And realistically, you know, maybe a bigger budget for this, sure, or maybe sure. Gaining more sponsorships with other community partners would be great.
Okay.
Sorry about that. So a lot of ours, or definitely some of our things, were redundant of what other people have already said. We think that right now cultural arts is too much focused on downtown, and that I think the last group also said that we thought there should be more activities in the winter, especially around cultural arts. The parks is doing a good job with their snowshoeing and different things, but we didn't think there was a lot of cultural arts being offered in the winter. We also like the 6-year Parks and Recreation Plan that the Parks Department was doing, and we recommend that they continue doing that. And we like that the fact that there's things that are offered at no or low cost, because we think that that's accessibility to all the citizens, and we would like that to see that continued. We want to continue to see cultural arts and parks in the city budget, at least at the level it is currently funded, if not higher. And we had a big aha moment when we realized that the library is not included in actually any of our presentations, and that we think that the library is doing a lot right now in cultural arts with their poetry readings, a bunch of their book stuff, and that we think that the library definitely needs to be mentioned in this section. And also someone in our group had mentioned that we also talked about that the library should be mentioned in the educational section, because the library is doing some great work. What additional actions? We think that there should be some effort to implement art in the new facility construction. So I don't know if that's a zoning code or something like that, but that encourages people to say, if you're gonna build a new building, you have to do some artistic thing in the building. Or one of the examples was, I guess there's been some artistic stuff that was done in the bathrooms at the port. That was one of the examples that they gave. And then new events in new locations. Again, kind of that idea of being spread out throughout the city and not just in the current locations that we're doing, and that we'd like to see innovative ideas with new partners. Someone mentioned to bring back some of the adult activities. I guess the city used to do things such as bingo, nightclubs, things like that, and we felt like some of those things were possibly missing. And then activities around the holidays, Halloween, Easter, caroling in the neighborhoods at Christmas time, things like that. For our 20-year goals, we would like to see Xfinity facility being more vibrant and being used more often, especially for things that draw in the community. The Art or History Museum, which hopefully is going to happen now at the down by the stadium. More emphasis on recreational opportunities such as kiteboarding, paddleboarding, biking, kayaking. We have such a unique city that no one else has, the geographic stuff that we have, and I don't feel like we emphasize that at all. And then keep Everett on the cultural map for the region. So we didn't prioritize our three. We chose not to do that part.
Follow the rule. So when you say more emphasis on recreational opportunities, and you said it's not mentioned at all, what did you, in terms of advertising, marketing, what?
I didn't mean to say it's not mentioned at all. I just think we have a very unique city. We have mountains on both sides. We have we're like Manhattan. We have water that goes around most of our area.
Yeah.
I mean, I know I paddleboard, and I don't see one person. I paddleboard down the river, and I don't see one person. I mean, people should be coming in from all over. It's a great facility for this. Let's get some bike trails. Let's promote. Hey, come to Everett to go paddleboard, and you can paddleboard down to Blue Water and have a drink afterwards or whatever.
Okay.
So I just mean including the geographic great locations that we have in our city that we're not emphasizing as much.
Okay. And I know there's a six-year parks plan, but is there a specific cultural element, like when you do the 6 years parks and recreation plan?
There is, and I probably should have to talk in the microphone.
Cultural arts is included in our six-year plan, and I was remiss for probably not pointing that out. It's not a large component, and actually Carol and I were just talking about perhaps when we revisit that would make sense to broaden the cultural arts component. She's a staff of one full-time FTE in the cultural arts division, and so I think we can do better at partnering in terms of our planning.
Okay. Well, it just struck me that a lot of these ideas could be written down and part of a plan somewhere, and it would make sense since you're doing that for parks.
Is some reference, okay. But again, I think we could spend some more time on that during our next process.
All right.
So we really wanted to be the first because we didn't want everybody to take all of our ideas. I think most of you were eavesdropping on our session.
That's right. That's what happened.
So our big thing was, like everyone else here, we want the city of Everett to be a city of destination as opposed to someplace else that you live here and go someplace else for recreation. Questions one and two, we answered together. Questions three and four, we essentially answered together. And so they're going to be combined. I actually have everything on one sheet. If you don't like my handwriting, that's okay. That's okay. I'm like you. It's my handwriting. We said yes I forget the question, but it is yes. We support the policies, and we think that they're doing great with that. With the caveat that there needs to be more events occurring in locations other than locations, other than the current locations, such as places like Lowell Community and South Everett. We like the idea of you maintaining the scholarships and the affordability. So then we went into three, which was close off of the streets temporarily. That will create an atmosphere for walking and more cultural events like a folk-like festival. The example would be like the folk-like festival with dance, music, food, storytelling, with a widespread advertising that is a joint and public and private funding. And the public and private funding is kind of huge, because if you don't get the businesses involved into some of these activities where some of the employers are actively involved, you're not going to get a widespread folks coming in, because many of the, what is it, what did they say, it's like 40% of the people leave Everett to go to work, but it's also 40% of the people come into Everett to go to work. So those, that 40%, we should be trying to make them stay here for whatever reason. And then we had one new little twist. Have, thanks to Mari, I do, this was a great idea. Have a combination center for seniors that has a preschool or daycare with some joint activities for the two of them, for the seniors and the preschoolers.
Okay. They call that cross-generational, right? Isn't that the term about, yeah, okay. Great, thank you. One more, perfect. I don't know if that cord's long enough. Everybody's been using this one over here. Roman, what group were you in?
That was it.
So I remember when I interviewed you right before this process started, your main thing was more stuff for families. Yep. That's what you wanted to see more than anything.
And I see it, I mean, like, and I hear it, I mean, like, from all other groups, I mean, like, so
yeah.
I'm glad to hear that.
So that was your piece in there about...
Yeah, and advertising, like I hear it, I mean, like, it's not advertised. I mean, like, schools are good, like, grounds where you can do that. I mean, like, because all of your Everett population is here. I mean, like, you just advertise it. Have flyers, have all kinds of stuff, I mean, like, in the schools. I mean, like, billboards, I mean, like, stuff on, like, public transit. I mean, like...
So make sure it's happening, but make sure people know about it.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Suzanne?
So our vision echoed a lot of other people. So kind of we feel like things are amazing. There's very visible partnerships. We've seen growth of programs over the last decade, and community engagement seems good, but it could be better. Our actions and goals are a bit kind of blending. So it seems like outreach is really good. We talked to the staff about their outreach efforts. One thing that's kind of lacking is other languages. Spanish is getting there, but we have like 85 languages spoken in a lot of our school districts. So we talked a little bit about ways to increase outreach, especially for English as a second language or non-English speakers. We talked about trying to, probably their biggest theme was really increasing open space in South Everett, because it just doesn't seem to a lot of us that it's really, if it's there, it's really not as advertised. So we talked about doing like micro parks. You know, they do that in some cities, like the size of parking spaces where there's trees and benches, and having, you know, bands play. And then we kind of got even more ambitious and thought maybe we need to talk about making an art hub in South Everett. So, you know, having, you know, public spaces and public art, but also trying to focus it in one area. We talked a little bit about around the Heritage Flight Museum. That already gets a lot of traffic. It's a museum. They have air shows, so could we do some other things? Maybe in another museum, maybe some other recreational activities like zip lining. So maybe kind of focusing a whole, another art, culture, and recreation hub down there. So that was probably like a real push. And then we also talked just about, in terms of like zoning, if there's a way to get, you know, businesses to plant more trees, can we have parking behind buildings just to make a nice frontage on the road? It's not really a park, but it does create a nicer walking and biking space. So.
Okay. Lots of very common themes among the groups tonight.
Yeah.
Spread it out more. Make sure it's not just in downtown. Multicultural, different languages, different kinds of opportunities. Kids and old people together, the cross-generational kind of thing. And yeah, very good, I think. There's a lot of synchronicity in those groups. Anybody have any final comments that your presenters didn't get across you want to make sure get offered up? Christopher?
Something that we did talk about in the group, but I forgot to mention, was just more events based around other cultures. So, for example, the Nubian Jam is great. I love going there. But Kika brought up, what about the Spanish community? You know, just welcoming more communities to have big events.
Okay. Only because I've heard it mentioned a couple of times, I want to point out something about the Nubian Jam. It's a joint venture with the City of Everett, but I want to tell you that the Nubian Jam is just a bunch of people that have gotten together. They're all volunteers. There are no paid people that put this jam on. I've been involved with it for the last 6 or 7 years, and I can tell you at the end of that Saturday night, I'm so glad to see it come because I'm exhausted. It is.
You're glad to see the night come?
Yes, I am, because I'm exhausted. And we would love to have more people come in and get involved. The Nubian Jam actually started because of five families got together and they wanted to have a picnic. And it's just spread to where it is. And that's the same thing. So in our talking about the closing off the streets, we were actually talking about something like, I went to Calgary this summer, and they have five blocks of nothing but a downtown corridor. It's pretty amazing. It gets pretty cold here in Calgary, so they had it covered. And it's pretty amazing, and it's some very upscale stores there, but they also had restaurants and other things that were there. And the same thing that I think that's kind of sort of the same thing that they were trying to do in Las Vegas. And we could do some of that there where it was just where you would have theme nights, or I think that's an outstanding idea. And take some of these parks. I went to Lowell Saturday. Down there, I went walking down there on the riverfront, but I also went by Lowell's Park. And I just think that's an outstanding space for us to just have, you know, plug in some guitars or something, and just anyone that comes down there wants to jam, just jam. Of course, the neighbors may not like it, but because that sound really goes uphill. But that's the kind of stuff that we were talking about. And so, yes, we are in agreement. I just wanted to point out that the Nubian Jam, it is nothing but volunteers.
All right, just to quickly.
Oh, I just wanted to tap on what Ben was saying, was just that I think that's what I'm hearing people say, is that they would like to see more of that encouraged throughout the city with other groups, other cultural groups, and multicultural groups. So if in some area there's a Russian or Ukrainian group that is, you know, proliferated in, it grows or is in an area, and then having festivals and events grown out and creating partnerships to grow events out of that, I think is what I hear people saying, is that they'd like to see more of what's going on with the Nubian Jam happen more for more groups in the city. So I think that's a lovely idea. Yeah.
Mari?
Yes, and that was the idea of, and I said specifically, not to sound like we're copying Seattle, but the Folklife Festival is sort of ethnically diverse and it's multicultural, and it also includes different art forms. It's dance and it's music and it's food and it's poetry readings, and there's a lot of different activities around that. Storytelling, you know, like someone who stands up and tells a folk tale from, I don't know, Turkey, and somebody stands up and tells a folk tale from Puerto Rico, where I'm from, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. I think using the example of the Nubian Jam, it's a ton of work and it's a ton of coordination and logistically very, very complex. So the idea that we have a department in the city that is in charge of recreation and cultural events, especially if, you know, there's going to be, it sounds like there might be a little more cross-pollination between these two areas, that's the kind of thing that they can be at the core of it and then sort of serve the role of coordination, sort of outreach, that kind of thing, and then people come in, all these different, you know, cultural groups that do exist, mm-hmm. Because it is a huge logistical undertaking, but once you have a city agency sort of headlining it, yeah. or coordinating, or then all that starts to happen. And the other thing that I think is, and again, this is a different, but there's a film festival in D.C. It's called the Environmental Film Festival. They use venues throughout the four quadrants of the city. So they show films in public libraries, in older theaters, in schools. Some of the venues seat 10 people, some seat 500. You know, they use embassies. And obviously, D.C. is a separate, you know, it has its own things that are different and unique about D.C. But the idea being that it doesn't necessarily have to be in one place. It doesn't have to be in Forest Park. It can be kind of a multi-day
sure.
event okay. and use venues from Lowell to you know, the yeah. Heritage Museum to, do you know what I'm saying? So it's a yeah. festival in the sense that there's all these things happening
yeah, like
in different Good. Venues with different groups, with different, but again, ideally you have someone who kind of is at the crux of the spider web so that it, so that was kind of
somebody
the idea
coordinating
that.
And doing
yeah.
that. Okay, good.
But that includes also the ethnic diversity that is growing in our city, and you know there are people from many different parts of the world, and I think that could also showcase, you know, help to showcase, and it can start okay. small. You know, it doesn't yeah. have to start as a.
Hey, I want to make sure that we have time to go over these questions on education and transportation. So how about if we do that, and then we'll come back, and if you have other ideas for the arts, cultural, and I just want to make sure we cover this, and then we'll come back and do any more additional ideas. I haven't heard, just quickly on your second draft of the housing recommendations, I haven't heard from anyone else. If you have anything and you want to tell me about them, we can go through that pretty quickly. There was a question on the 600 new housing units for downtown that was in there in our five-year measure. A couple of people had that question. One person said, that doesn't sound like enough, and another person said, yeah, it didn't make sense. And I just want you to know that as we continue to work on these things, so Alan had given kind of a first shot at that. I'm going to have Bob and Alan and Paul go through all of these with a fine-tooth comb and make sure that the five-year measures are realistic and on target and double-check all those numbers. So probably is going to have some adjusting that gets done, but it'll be looked at very carefully again. Do you want to weigh in on that?
No, that's
okay.
That's fine.
Julie.
So number four, the social impact investing, that's still not completely accurate.
Okay.
So that, I mean, that is permanent supportive housing, that
yeah.
bullet right there. So
okay.
then social impact would be a separate bullet.
A different one. Okay.
Yeah. And Maddie followed up with the email about that, so maybe.
Yeah, I had Maddie and Julie give me some ideas about that. How about if I give it one more shot
okay.
and get it back out?
Yeah. It's almost like the second bullet on page two is close to impact investing.
Yeah, okay.
So right. just so you know, what
Great.
You said there is close to what.
And when you gave me that better definition of social impact investing, I thought, oh, I better go back and double check that. So
I was late, sorry.
So I'll do that. No, that's fine. Good. Thank you guys for that feedback. Anybody else, anything on housing? You'll have another shot at all this. I just want to get anything that we might have now. Okay, so let's talk about education coming up and the transportation discussion. So education and transportation, we're on an agenda for our April, I think, 24th meeting. And we had them double billed for some, just because we were kind of running out of time. But as I said in my email to you and in this agenda, it seems like you've made some really good recommendations related to education. And I'm even picking up some more here in terms of partnerships with schools and using the schools to really advertise to families, that kind of thing. So I'm wondering if we could almost call education done. From the group, just because there's very little influence the city really has on the districts per se, other than partnerships and working hard with them, and because the city's done such a good job of attracting that higher education that was called out in the 2025 plan. Bob, I don't know if you want to weigh in on this.
That says it well. I mean, there's only so much that the city can influence in terms of education because we have two K-12 school districts. And frankly, they don't really like us getting into their business very well. So we can influence things from afar to some degree, and we can create some partnerships, and we did some of the things that were brought out tonight, I think, were good ideas and other opportunities. But I don't know that in combining a session with where we have both education and transportation, whether we could do justice to transportation. I think that that's one where, especially if we're focused on sidewalks and bike trails and transit within the city rather than, you know, how to fix I-5, there's plenty to talk about there. And there's only so much more we can do with education. So that's where that was coming from.
Christopher, you had some thoughts.
Education in schools have been obviously a constant theme, and I think Angie said it in like week two, and something that I think about pretty frequently is the schools are a very vital component, and Bob, I thank you for explaining kind of the gap there. I'm not sure whether or not we should leave it on or take it off, but I do think that an essential component of Everett moving forward is going to be a relationship with the schools, maybe a stronger partnership than we have right now. Because no matter what we decide here, I mean, these could be award-winning ideas. The kids in those schools are the ones inheriting it. And so if we have great ideas, if we have terrible ideas, whatever it is, they're the ones coming up next. They'll be on, you know, the next.
Right. So I'm looking at it from the standpoint of this is going to be a report to the city council, mm-hmm. those seven elected leaders plus the mayor. Mm-hmm. Each of our school districts has its own elected board of five people, and they make the decisions for the school district. So to the degree that we talk to each other and again, partner in certain programs here and there, that's great. But we're not going to be able to fundamentally change what they do from the city, from City Hall. That's part of what Everett citizens need to do in electing their school boards, for sure. But in terms of this group's time, I'm just trying to think of where the value is.
And we, you know, we do have these four draft recommendations that are, I think, pretty good. And like I said, just even tonight, hearing more. But we call specifically, the first one is continue to strengthen ties, and there's language in here about making those partnerships stronger, to your point, Christopher. But, you know, and we still have time with these recommendations. We're just talking about not having another presentation or small group discussions on them, but they're still in the document. Yeah. Maddie.
I would agree with you that I think we've covered education. I just want to make sure two things, that the library comment that was brought up today, that I mean, because to me the library is doing a good job of educating our citizens, both kids and adults, and any influence that the city has, especially around adult education with the colleges. So for the citizens of Everett, again, I know you don't have any direct contact, but I think the city probably has the ability to influence that. So is there opportunities for the Wazoo or the community college to offer, you know, adult education stuff?
Yeah, and again, there actually is very little influence that the city has on Everett Community College, and I say that as the chair of the Board of Trustees at Everett Community College. It's its own entity, and it's part of a state system. So that's, and it's, I think it's, you know, going pretty well without the city trying to, micromanage it at all. WSU and the other four-year institutions at the University Center are benefiting from the city's lobbying in Olympia, where we're constantly talking about expanding opportunities, and we're succeeding there. So I think that's a really good role that the city can play, and we are playing, and we're seeing results.
I will definitely add that library piece back into these education recommendations, though. It was in here at one point, and I'm not sure if we switched it to somewhere else or not. I'll double check, but we'll make sure it's in here. Sharita, no, Ben, okay?
My question is, how much the human services department, do you have a human services department?
No,
you
don't? That's the county.
Yeah. Okay, then it's moot, because it is... It's moved.
So I have a question. So do you want us to give our other feedback to you separately, or do you want it now?
On the education ones? We can do this for a few minutes, and then I would want you to do it again, like we'll do a like an editing thing we've been doing online, but let's take a few minutes.
Just because understanding the framework like that we're going off of, number two seems extremely specific that our 20-year vision would somehow include drug use prevention as our target. I mean, we have so many social issues, and that we as a vision would decide that that is our primary. And maybe it should be, but it seems that the city might not decide that that was its primary or only focus.
So I pulled this out of our original drug use recommendations because it was so strongly tied to the school. It was originally in crime and drug use. As I was writing it, I thought, you know, we should broaden this to talk about all sorts of social issues. But education is a prevention factor for drug use was a really important issue for this group. So I didn't want to lose that. But you're right. I mean, it should be broader. So,
and again, it's not the city's not going to mandate that to the schools to do.
Right.
And then I think the other piece, like number four, how we originally came to wanting to even have education at the table is there was still some perceived ideas that Everett doesn't have a strong education system. Yeah. And as we grow our economy and we want people to come and work and live here, we want them to understand that we have both of our school districts are excellent. And so that was dispelling that myth and that marketing piece.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. This was originally in economic development. Right. So, yeah. And I just thought it was really important, and I thought having it as education would be good. Chris?
Just a quick question for Bob. Would it be reasonable, 20 years from now at WSU, I assume we'd want that to be a branch campus, a full branch campus?
It essentially is already.
Okay, there's nothing else.
The only thing that it doesn't have is full autonomy from Pullman.
Okay.
But I think way less than 20 years, it'll be there.
Okay, is there anything that a vision statement would be helpful in terms of direction at the state level?
I don't think so. I mean, I think we're on that track. I don't think it would make that much of a difference. I think just continuing on the path that we're on, because 20 years from now, whether it's a branch campus or not, may not matter.
Okay.
Things may change that much. I mean, that's kind of using today's lens, right?
Right.
In saying what we want, and structure may be completely different at that point.
Okay.
Like what we want are more four-year opportunities,
right?
For students who are from here,
right,
to be able to take advantage of a four-year education right here at home.
Ethel?
I just want to say we're talking about the schools. To let you guys know, the Council of Neighborhoods for the City of Everett have a partnership with the Everett School District. We just had our second meeting with them a couple of weeks ago. I think you were there at the meeting. And we are working together and to solve problems that we're having in our schools and finding ways that they can help us and we can help them. So it is a very strong partnership. Dr. Stewart is very, very active with us, and they really want to see this thing work. So they're working hard, and Everett has a good school system.
Good, I will put that in here as something to continue on, and you know that it's there and it's existing, and that's the kind of thing that this committee wants to see fostered in the future,
right?
All right, good. Brenda?
I thought of a way that the city might be able to help with our social issues education, since we can't have a say. In the Everett School District, we can maybe offer scholarships and maybe even do them three times a year if we really want to highlight, you know, whatever social issue at the time that we need to help our kids not fall into and increase our safety and health in our city. Do we offer any scholarships now from the city to the schools?
I don't know that the city does, but there's lots of nonprofits that do.
Okay.
So there's lots of that in the city of
Everett.
It's just
not
city government
issues
necessarily doing it.
Anyway, I like that idea.
In last weekend's paper, there was a list of all businesses and organizations that were giving out scholarships to kids in the Everett School District, Muckleteel School District, and so they do a program every year for them. And I think they do it once or twice a year. So.
And it's just regarding social issues like drug use and things like that, or is it just for good students?
Just for the students and different activities they participated in.
Like a competition for each school gets $100, you know, and just involve the school in that, or some scholarship money from the city saying, and this is your theme, and the theme can change according to what city council would want to address in the school. So I think offering scholarships and contests would be a way for the city to interact with the schools and promote that a healthy city.
Okay.
Thanks. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Sharita.
I just really quickly want to say that I hope that we can include language in the educational piece that encourages a civic engagement piece, especially going to the schools, the high schools, the middle schools, to start encouraging at that age young people getting involved in the process of growing their community, building their community, and being part of the process as they get older. And what that looks like, it can be many different things, but how we do that, I think, is going to help grow our city generations to come if we pay mind to that. So yeah. So.
Okay, very good. Angie?
I just want to add on to that. There are a few, well, I know personally of three or four, plus the mayor, that currently go around to schools and read to kids, and we might not see it all the time, but they're there. So possibly just including, I mean, just expanding on what's already happening. It is, but there's a lot of responsibility.
Okay. I just think that we could make more of a concerted effort in how we grow our young people's seeing the value in that. I mean, we used to have back in the day when some of us were young, lots of opportunity to participate in community development in our high schools and in our middle schools, and mm-hmm. we don't have that anymore. We've walked, you know, we've turned our backs on that, and yet we constantly question why children and young people aren't participating in the process. And so I think that we need to look at a more holistic way of bringing that back, the civic engagement education back into the schools, and working with the city and the college and growing that piece. I mean, Paul Roberts and I were talking about a young man that I'm hoping to get engaged in the process in whatever way that I can, as somebody who's not his mom, as just a community advocate, and hoping to encourage, you know, credit, you know, for writing a speech to present to city council. I mean, encouraging that sort of engagement, again, I think is really super important. So,
great.
So, yeah.
Okay. We need to go on to transportation. Mari, go ahead.
It's very quick. It's sort of piggybacking on what Sharita was saying. I wonder if, and also what Angie said, if there's a way to start some kind of cooperation whereby people who are involved in municipal government, in city government, can visit a school for some kind of special assembly, again, just so that so more children get more direct exposure to how city government works and what it means to, and when you vote, this is what you're voting for. And these are your city council people. This is what they do. And again, just geared to the level of the kids, but just more direct exposure to kind of civics with a capital C, you know, just the civics of how government works and what your city government does.
So let me add
why it's important that
you guys have given good ideas. Let me add these to this draft, knowing that this draft is ongoing, it keeps going. We just won't have another presentation on education per se, but we will devote that meeting to transportation.
And are we thinking we're going to do civic engagement?
We are doing civic engagement.
So a lot of this could go under civic engagement.
Right.
I mean, I think that civic engagement isn't just for adults, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We have a whole meeting devoted to that, which we added in. So, and so we'll talk about the transportation agenda in just a second. I just want to let you know that in the next week or so, I'm going to go through, get consistency in all of the various sections, take out redundancies, et cetera, and have Bob look at the 5-year success measures and really get that working draft going. And it'll be on one hub, and I'll send you all the documents as well. It doesn't sound like we want to do a lot of group editing, so you're going to need to be checking in on this on a regular basis. And I'm going to add an agenda piece to each meeting going forward, which are any comments on the working draft. So I want you all to be looking at this, and then if there are things you want to share as a group, we'll do that together. But we won't be spending 2 hours doing group editing, because that didn't sound like a good idea to anybody the last time we talked about it. So that'll be the process going forward, because when we get to May 22nd, the last thing we want is a lot of people being unhappy with the documents. So that's our kumbaya meeting. We're all going to celebrate and have fun at that time. So I want to make sure that folks are looking and reviewing, and we're making changes as we go along. So this idea about transportation, focusing on pedestrian safety, sidewalks, bicycles, how we get around, cross-town stuff, does that appeal to you? Is that what we should do for our presentation for transportation? Is that where you want to focus? That's the sense we've had from previous meetings, so I'm just double-checking. Does that kind of do it for us for transportation? Because it's a different kind of a person who comes in.
It's as opposed to work on I-5 and the big stuff, which is kind of already baked in for the next almost 20 years, frankly, with the legislation that's already been approved. So,
is it possible to get an overview of that piece, but to focus on that, the pieces that you
sure.
mentioned?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, just have some sort of thing.
Just a really brief kind of update.
Just really brief,
sort of thing.
Here's what's already in the pipeline.
Okay. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, sure.
How does the light rail part, how do you see that being a part of this conversation?
So that's a good point because, you know, with Sound Transit coming here by 2036, we hope, that's going to open up the need for connections to transit stations. And so we have to be thinking about that too. Are they going to be accessible for pedestrians, for bicycles? How do you get to the light rail station in a reasonable way? And so, yes, I think that's part of it. And we can address what's in the pipeline, kind of the timeline of what's coming and where stations are planned and all of that. Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Could we, Angie, as we talk about that, could we also, maybe slightly expand the discussion around what like light rail landing pads look and feel like, parking, open space.
I mean, Sound Transit is going to decide that. Mm-hmm. You know, they have a design for their stations. Basically, it'll change a little bit with each one, but the basic structure is already in the plan. It's already been approved.
So, in this quick update, could you help us see that? I mean,
that won't be quick.
Just high level.
I mean, yeah. I mean, I don't know that we have. Yeah, have to get drawings of something else that might not be representative. It's some of them are elevated, some of them are ground level. I think the bigger issue for this group is going to be just connections, getting there and getting around, and what does the arrival of light rail do for you know north? That's a north-south corridor. How do we do the east-west connections to that type thing?
So I guess, I mean, I have some exposure to it, so I know, but do we drive from 85th and Evergreen Way to Painfield and Park? Or are we going to hop on a bus? Or, I mean, that, because...
Yeah, I guess that gets into the bigger, yeah, higher, yeah, broader regional discussion of, okay, transportation, and I was thinking a more localized look for this group might be more beneficial because those are the things that the city council is going to have more control over and more influence over.
How about if Bob and I do some noodling on this and kind of come up with a structure for what, mm-hmm, a presentation would be for our transportation night? We'll double check that back with you guys, kind of what's a high level update versus some of the other details we want to get into. We still have a little bit of time to fiddle with that before, I think that's our April 24th meeting. So we'll do that and then come really prepared that night. We just wanted to make sure we had the focus in the right place. Positives about Everett? Got something to share before we adjourn? Come on, today was a great day for Everett. A lot of, go ahead, Angie.
Not last weekend, but the weekend before. We don't get out a whole lot late at night with little kids, but we were out and there were 11 o'clock, tons of people walking around Everett. It was happy and people were laughing and felt safe and
fantastic.
Very good. It was awesome.
Christopher?
Just what I sent you in the email, beginning with this process, but everything else going on, you know, I see an Everett for everyone that's been stuck in my head since we started doing this.
Yeah.
So I would, I think it's possible, and I think this group really cares to see that happen.
Yeah, good. Yeah, Chris sent me that phrase. I said, I think that's really good. We'll get Everett for everyone. An Everett for everyone, somewhere in our language. I thought it was really positive. I was just going to add that the editorial today in the Seattle Times was really good for Everett, I thought, in terms of the lawsuit against Big Pharma. It was very positive. All right, thank you. See you in 2 weeks. Thanks. April 10th.
Thank you.